Hello, good evening. I thought that was the more polite way to break up the conversation than just interrupting. But wow, great group here, good sized group here tonight for Bible study. Thank you all for coming out. Glad to see all of you tonight. We'll have some singing here in a little bit that kind of relates to the theme from this morning's sermon. But first, who can we be praying for? What can we be giving thanks for or lifting up in prayer? I've got this morning's prayer list in front of me, but is there anyone else that we want to add tonight? Sue?
A co-worker of mine and Daryl's, Richard Kingle, passed away. So keep his wife, Lana, and family in prayer.
Was the last name Kingle?
Tingle.
All right, we'll pray for that family. I'm sorry for the loss. Yeah.
Teachers did great, so just grateful for that. And then I got to be in here and be very, very refreshed.
Yeah, that is something to give thanks for, that our new quarter of children's Bible classes was kicked off well. That is something to give thanks for. Well, if that's everything, then let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll have a little bit of singing together, so bow with me, please. Thank you, Lord, for the afternoon that we've had since worship today. Thank you, those of us who were at April Feltner's house for a meal. Thank you for the time we got to spend in fellowship with one another. Thank you for bringing us back together tonight. We ask that you'll bless this time, that you'll bless our hearts and minds as we open up your word again, and as we discuss what we see in there, and as we think through some things, we pray that it'll be a beneficial discussion for all of us. Lord, we lift up those that we've mentioned tonight. We pray for the Tingle family and the loss of Richard. Bless them in this time of sadness and grief. Please walk with them in the days and months and the time to come. Missing Richard, watch over and bless them. Lord, we also want to give you thanks. Today was a start of a new quarter for our children's Bible classes. We thank you that the quarter started off well, that the new teachers did well, and we pray that you'll continue to bless our children, continue to bless the teaching that they receive. We pray that they will be instructed and taught how to walk in your ways and how to live faithfully for you, and we pray that the teaching that they receive now can bear fruit for many years to come. Lord, bless our time together tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, let's do a little bit of singing together. I picked out three songs, two of which I think we'll know. The middle one, I think we will know, but it might be new to some of you. But this first song seems especially appropriate in light of this morning's sermon, Sweet Hour of Prayer. This is also one of my all-time favorite songs as well, but let's sing this together. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne make all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, the joy I feel, the bliss those whose anxious spirits burn with strong desires for thy return. With such I hasten to the place where God my Savior shows his face, and gladly take my station there and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, thy wings shall my petition bear to him whose truth and faithfulness engage the waiting soul to bless. And since he bids me seek his face, believe his word, and trust his grace, I'll cast on him my every care and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer. Second song is called Unto Thee, O Lord. How many of you know this song? Good, good. A few hands going up. There is an echo with the men lead and then the women follow. So men, be sure to sing out with me at the beginning of each verse. But it's pretty simple song. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Yea, let none that wait on thee be ashamed. Yea, let none that wait on thee be ashamed. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me. Remember not the sins of my youth. Remember not the sins of my youth. My God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me. Amen. Last song let's sing is I Need Thee Every Hour. This, I think, ties in with the idea of persistence, coming to God on a regular basis. I need thee every hour.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No. tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
I think that's a little low. Let me try to raise it for the second verse.
I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. In joy or pain, come quickly and abide, or life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Amen. Well, go ahead and be opening up your Bibles. If you'd like, if you have your Bibles with you, you may want to be opening them mainly to Luke chapter 11, the second of the two parables that we talked about this morning. We'll talk about both of them, but when we get into some details, I think we'll mostly be focusing on the second of the two parables. But both of the parables that we talked about this morning, one is the parable of the widow who keeps going back to the unjust judge again and again until she gets justice against her adversary, against this person who's trying to take advantage of her. The other was the parable of the friend at midnight, the friend who had someone come from a journey and he needs bread for that friend, so he goes to his neighborhood friend and has to knock and knock and knock on the door until that person finally gives him the bread. And both of these parables make really strong assertions, really. When Jesus goes into the application section, really strong assertions that God will hear and will answer our prayers. And it's really stated in very, well, kind of in no uncertain terms. If you keep coming to God persistently, he will hear and he will answer your prayers. And that's a really comforting message. But it's a message that can have some tension with our daily experiences in our own prayer lives. I think many of us, probably all of us, honestly, have had moments where our prayers at least seem to go unanswered. Or I know sometimes we say there are no unanswered prayers, and I agree with that as well. I don't believe there are truly unanswered prayers, but there are prayers that sometimes seem to not be answered the way that we were hoping they would be answered. And so I think that's a good question to just begin to discuss tonight. Why is it that you think that some prayers I will say go unanswered, but I don't really believe they're. Why do you think this happens sometimes? That sometimes prayers are not answered the way that we have been hoping and desiring, and the way that, from our perspective, seems best. Why do you think that happens? Bob. Oh, okay. We'll go over here first.
God gives us what we need, not necessarily what we want.
God gives us what we need. Yeah. And sometimes maybe what we want is, sometimes what we think we need might actually not be what we need. Yeah. Bob?
I think in essence that sometimes we think our prayer's not answered because God knows what's best for us. And sometimes he may not answer because of that reason. And on the other hand, if God gives us what we need and not what we want, it can be devastating to us. So I think on the flip side of that is that God knows our needs, and he knows if he answers those prayers, it will not be beneficial to us. And that's sometimes why we don't get answered.
That's maybe a good thing to keep in mind about what it really means to love someone. You know, at the heart of love is not just wanting to keep someone happy or something like that. At the heart of it is wanting what is best for someone. And sometimes what is best for someone is not what they want to be told or not what they want to have happen to them. But that can be an important principle that can help us sometimes. I don't know that everything that we say here, I think we have to put kind of conditions on it and realize there may be other circumstances as well at work. But I think that is often a big one. Sometimes what we need and what is best for us is not in line with what we think we need. Yeah. Bob, you had your hand up again.
A friend of mine really wanted a husband. And she prayed and she prayed for a husband, but she never get a husband. Mm. And that's why I say sometimes God knows the response. And she says her prayer hasn't been answered. Maybe it was answered. She doesn't know. But it could have been answered because of that reason.
That is a difficult challenge, a difficult issue when someone is praying for something that would be such a fundamental relationship. Did anyone else have a hand up? I thought I saw another hand go up. Let's go Nathaniel and then Kelsey and then Joe.
I've heard it said that there are three answers to prayer: yes, no, and not right now. I believe a lot of times we can misconstrue a not right now as a no, and yeah, we can also misconstrue a no as a not right now. Yeah. I think a lot of it depends on what's best for you at the moment, and the Lord knows that. My example is that I was set to be a police officer, and that was 2015. Things were going okay at the moment, but I believe God answered me with a no. I heard it as a not right now, and looking back, you know, within the past year or so, I've come to realize it was a real blessing to hear a no. So yeah, in the moment, I was very hurt. I've also had yeses. I've had some yeses that should have been no's, but I think it's all in love and to teach us what the ultimate lesson is.
Yeah. I appreciate you saying that, because I remember some of our conversations where at times you were thinking that was a not right now answer, and other times you were thinking it was a no answer. And that's, thank you for sharing that. Kelsey.
To be honest, I struggle with this a lot because sometimes I just don't think that there is a good answer to that question. I think all these are good answers, but I think there's also an answer that is, I just don't know why God doesn't answer prayers the way that we want him to. And because I've also prayed for things and, you know, they've not been answered the way that we would have wanted. And there doesn't seem like there's any good reason for it whatsoever. And you can try to say, well, you know, God, you'll learn a lesson or this or that. But sometimes it's just not easy to understand. And I think that scripture is full of people who feel that way. You know, you look at the Psalms and people saying, like, how long, O Lord, will you leave us? How long will we feel abandoned? How long, you know, or just all these different emotions. And also makes me think of the passage, is it in Romans, where it says, you know, sometimes God just says, look, I'm the potter and you're the clay. And I don't have to have an answer, you know, for you sometimes. It's, I'm God and you're the creation. So sometimes that's hard to accept, but sometimes that's where I'm at, is I just don't know.
I think that that is very important as we ask this question and give different answers. That's a very important answer to have in addition to other answers we might give. Sometimes the answer is simply unknown to us. We have a limited human perspective. We don't always know why things happen in the world the way they do. And sometimes I don't know is the only legitimate answer that we can have. And I think that's important to remember. And all the answers that we're giving, like you were saying, can be good answers, but they don't always apply to every situation. And that is why I don't know is sometimes the answer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ms. Jo.
I agree with Nathaniel. That's what I was gonna say.
Oh yeah.
Sometimes it's later. Just like you do with children, you know, if they want to play with a knife or play in the traffic, you won't let them.
Right.
But
right.
As they get older, well, you know, you let them help you in the kitchen and they learn how to handle it.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
That's all.
Any other thoughts on this?
You know, just like in the Bible, they had to.
Yeah.
So we have to persevere and just wait.
Yeah. Sometimes, like in the parable, it's not about asking for something one time. Sometimes we pray continually. Yeah. We're knocking on the door like the friend at midnight. Well, I'm pointing up there. The scripture's not up there. I'm sorry. I'm used to doing that. But we're like the people in these parables sometimes. Thinking through this type of question, why do some prayers seem to go unanswered? Why do some prayers not get the answer that we want? Ties into a question that on Wednesday nights we're going to ask in a couple of weeks. And I'm not saying this just to advertise for Wednesday night class. I do that when we start new series and things, but I'm really not doing that right now. Not this Wednesday, but next. We're basically going to be dealing with the question of why do bad things happen to good people? And that's very similar to this type of question. And so I encourage you, if that is something that weighs on your heart through your own personal experiences or experiences with other people you know, even if you've not been coming to our other Wednesday night classes, I think that that would be a worthwhile class to attend. So it won't be this Wednesday, it'll be the Wednesday after that. We'll dive into some, this question that we're asking tonight is part of a bigger question, and we will deal with that bigger question in a couple of Wednesdays from now. Well, going along with that, I'm sorry, one other thing I wanted to say on this question before moving on to the next one. When we ask this question, why do some prayers not get the answer that we may want? That's actually asking a question. I tried to draw this out this morning in the sermon. It's actually asking a question that I think is a little bit beyond the message of these parables. I think it's important that we think about what Jesus is actually saying God will give in response to prayer in these parables. Now, in Scripture, God will answer prayers all the time for different requests. But in these parables, as he applies these parables, he mentions two things specifically. The message of the parables is not that God will answer all of our prayers, no matter what they are, if we just pray consistently. God is talking about two things in particular. He's saying that God, no matter what we're facing, will give us strength. The Holy Spirit is what empowers and equips us. He will give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him. And he talks about, in the parable with the widow, going to the unjust judge, he talks about there will come a day when Jesus returns and everything is set right. There is no more injustice. There is everything is set the way it's supposed to be. And that's at Jesus' return. And it's not that God does not want to right wrongs in the world between now and then. It's not that he is uninterested in that. But there is coming a time when all the wrongs will be made right. And in the parables, those are the two specific things that Jesus encourages us to direct to God in prayer. And those are two things that he will answer. And so I think that keeping that the specific message of these parables in mind can also be helpful when we think about a question like this. So going along with that question comes another one that I think is worth thinking about tonight. We all know that God knows everything there is to know, right? He knows everything. including exactly what we need. He knows what we're going to pray for. And Jesus even says this. This isn't just something that we deduce logically. Jesus says, your Heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask Him. He says that in the Sermon on the Mount. So why is it that God still wants us to persistently pray to Him, you think, if He already knows what we need? Why do you think it is that God wants us to persistently pray like the people do in this parable, even if God already knows what we need?
I think that it can bring us closer to God, for one thing.
It can bring us closer to God as we pray. So there is some benefit to us from prayer that we would not have if we just let God give us everything we need before we ask. That's important, yeah.
Throughout that, because that's the only way that he can speak to us is through His Word. Mm.
So,
if you keep it, doesn't I mean if you keep knocking, then you'll be answered.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you keep staying in His Word and keep diligent with it, then it will help you grow, and sometimes I'm thinking, okay, so what is, I pray, but His will be done, so I just pray for strength now, to be able to withstand whatever is thrown at me. You just see what I mean?
Yeah, so sometimes the answer is actually already in the pages of God's Word. So maybe this goes back to the first question: why do some prayers not get answered the way we want them to? Well, maybe the answer is already in front of us, in black and white on the pages, and we may not know that if we have not taken time to listen to God, because prayer is in one way part of a conversation. We talk to God, and God has spoken to us through His Word. And if we want to actually have a relationship, both members of that relationship have to have a voice. And so we have to listen to God's voice and not just make our voices heard to God. Yeah. Mary.
Like in your lesson you were talking about today, ask and it will be given to you, knock. So we have to ask. That's what He tells us, even though He knows what we want. But He wants us to do that. He tells us what we need to do. So we need to follow His direction. And not only that, when we focus on praying and asking God for things, we don't have time to focus on the bad stuff. We be thinking about all the good stuff. We are becoming more like Christ, in other words.
Yeah. So I'm hearing again the benefit that we have from approaching God in prayer. God already knows what we need before we ask Him, but there is a blessing for us in coming to God in prayer that we could not have if we didn't come to God in prayer. Yeah. Kelsey and then Nathaniel. Yeah.
I struggle with sometimes the one-sided feeling of prayer, and I've often struggled with that and tried to figure out how to improve that and done different things, and sometimes it just hits me that Jesus prayed. I'm like, well, why did Jesus pray? Like, what was, like, He was God in the flesh, so He was still God. So you're sitting here and you're like, well, surely He knows the mind of God, He knows the will of God. What was the point of Him praying? And you're like, well, there was obviously a very huge point to Him praying, and it was the relationship. It was a connection to His Father.
Yeah.
And that's just such a huge example. And when He teaches His disciples how to pray, like He's trying to show them, like, this is of utmost importance, important that I have to leave and be by myself and take this time to talk to my Father.
Yeah.
And that is just such an example to me that hits me sometimes of, this isn't just a one-sided conversation. Like, it's not sometimes how it feels. What it actually is a connection directly to the Father that Jesus modeled for us.
Yeah. So thinking about why did Jesus have to pray, I think one answer is He did it to give us an example for praying to God. And Jesus even says that before He raises Lazarus from the dead. He prays aloud to God, and He says, like, I'm not praying for my own sake, I'm praying for everyone who can hear me right now. And so that is part of why he prays. And also, I think this is a little speculative because, you know, it's really not our business to try to figure out the relationship between Father and Son and Spirit. It's quite a mystery. But that relationship, even that relationship, it seems, maybe you could say, has to be maintained. You know, it is not just an automatic, passive relationship. Jesus maintained his relationship with God by praying to him. In the same way, we have to maintain our relationship with God also. Nathaniel.
Just as a more basic thing that, I feel like I got kind of deep, but more on the surface is that, you know, the next verse is, so I say to you, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks the door will be opened. Mm-hmm. So why should we have to pray? Well, I mean, it kind of goes back to the kid who has knowledge and the parent who doesn't, but the parent finds out something and the kid says, or the parent says, well, why didn't you tell me that? And the kid says, why didn't you ask? Mm. You know, because, you know, God doesn't just, he won't just give us everything. We have to ask for it first. Mm-hmm.
That's right. Yeah, he does. He wants us to ask him. Yeah. Well, Doris. Yeah.
In prayer, I look at that as a conversation with God. Mm-hmm. And if you're asking God for something, maybe if you have time to think about that and bounce that around, that you either change exactly what it is you're originally asking for, or maybe it's like, wait, this isn't the will of God that I would go this direction. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like you're having a conversation with someone and you're batting idea. You know, it's that two-way thing, and you kind of, I don't know, you know, God don't speak directly back to me or anything, but I can seem like feel that way. You know, you're telling you finally get to the point where you say, listen to myself. You know, it's like, yep. You know, maybe I don't really need this. This wouldn't be the way that God might want me to do this. Yep. I might need to look at it differently or look at something different.
Yeah, that's a great point, Ms. Doris. Prayer can be a learning process for us. You know, as we pray, there may be insights and perspectives that we take on that we wouldn't have, that would not have come to us if we had not been praying. Kind of like, sometimes you may go, if something is really on your mind, you may go and confide in someone. And I've had this happen to me loads of times, where as I'm talking to someone, it's like the answer becomes obvious before they even have to say anything back. And it was so not obvious to me earlier, you know, but talking through it with someone can give us guidance. And the same with prayer as we're talking to God. Yeah. Ms. Jo, you had your hand up.
Yeah. Well, I was thinking of something personal as a parent. You know, I've received cards sometimes from my daughters-in-law, but if my sons bothered to write their name themselves, it touched me as a parent. That's the only way that we can, it doesn't always have to be for asking purposes, it's communication.
Yeah.
It's God is love, and how do you tell him?
Yeah.
You know, you just stay in touch. If you never heard from your wife, or if you never said I love you, you know, to your spouse, you know, you'd be missing out on something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's such a great insight. It may be that God wants us to pray to him partially because he just wants to hear from us. You know, he may know what we need inside and out, but he loves us. And what loving parent doesn't want to hear from their children? Yeah, that's a great insight. The only other thing I would add to everything we've been saying, this is also a bit of a mystery, because I think we would probably all acknowledge in here that God, well, he knows everything that there is to know. And yet, in the Bible, God acts in response to prayer and sometimes changes his mind in response to prayer. And so in addition to everything we've been saying, you can also actually affect the future with your prayers. I know that seems like a mystery if God already knows it all, but the Bible seems to indicate what God takes our prayers into account as he makes decisions and things. And so we can change our lives and change other people's lives and change the future for the better if we pray. So it actually brings about, it actually makes a difference. It is not just a self-help thing, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Yeah. I was going to move on to something else, but before I do, let me just pause and say, any other questions or reflections, comments on any of the things we've talked about so far?
I've seen on Facebook where a child is holding a little teddy bear and Jesus is holding a great big one behind his arm. So sometimes you don't get what you want. He wants to give you more, better, bigger.
Yes, sometimes what we think we want is so much less than what God actually intends to give us. Yeah, that's a great point as well. All right. Well, Luke 11, the parable of the friend at midnight. I mentioned something in the sermon that I planned to come back to tonight, and figured since I said that, I need to make good on it and actually come back to it. Luke 11, verses 5 through 8. Maybe it's best if I just read the parable again since it's short before getting into this. So let's just read the parable again. He also said to them, suppose one of you has a friend and goes to him at midnight and says to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I don't have anything to offer him. Then he will answer from inside and say, don't bother me. The door is already locked and my children and I have gone to bed. I can't get up to give you anything. I tell you, even though he won't get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his friend's shameless boldness. Ooh, I like the way this translation translates that. Because of his friend's shameless boldness, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. All right, so the friend at midnight. This person has a friend come in on a journey. He needs to feed him. He can't feed him. This is an embarrassing, shameful thing. It means you're a bad host. So he goes to his neighborhood friend in the middle of the night and knocks on the door. And then we just read everything that happens. One thing that is interesting to me, I think, this you may agree with what I'm about to say. You may not be fully persuaded by it. If not, it's okay. That's part of why I didn't dive into it in the sermon, because it felt a little extra, I guess. But the term friend, the Greek word behind friend in our English Bibles, is a term that had a range of meanings at the time of the New Testament. It could mean a friend like we mean it, just like a pal, someone we get along with, someone we know, we have good relationship with. It could mean something like that. It could mean that. But it could also mean something like patron. It could mean something like patron. Now, patron isn't a term that we use a lot today. We do use it some, but not a lot. But patron would tie into this ancient relationship in Jesus' time called the patron-client relationship. Way back a couple of years ago when I taught a class in here on the New Testament world, we talked about that, but I imagine it's all completely fuzzy by now. The patron-client relationship. We don't really, I mean, maybe we have something like this in our world today, but nothing exactly as formal as this. And it was all over Jesus' world. It wasn't like an obscure type of relationship. It was a relationship that people knew very well. It was a way of making ends meet in a world that didn't have a lot of the government programs and other kind of safety networks that we have in our world today. This was a way of making sure society ran. Basically, a wealthy person who has a lot of resources, and wealthy people in Jesus' time could be very wealthy, they would have clients under them, people who were poor, basically. And the client would come to the patron and ask for something, and the patron would give them what they needed. And in return, the client was supposed to give honor to the patron, basically was supposed to make the patron look good, supposed to advance his reputation in society. This is all part of an honor-shame culture where honor and shame is everything, really. So a needy person comes to a less needy person, a wealthy person, gets what they need, and instead of repaying them, basically the client talks about how wonderful the patron is and makes the patron look really good and gives him honor, makes him a respectable member of society. And this system went from the lowest rung of society all the way up to the top. Basically, everyone was a client of somebody, and almost everyone was also a patron of somebody. And it went on and on up the social ladder until you got to the emperor, the Roman emperor at the very top. He was the patron of the Roman Empire. And actually, above him, I guess you could say he was a client to the gods. But it went all the way up to the top and trickled all the way down, patron client, from the top down to the bottom. It's all a system based on honor and shame, which if you've been in Romans class, we've talked a lot about that. It's a very different way of thinking about the world than our modern Western culture thinks about it. But anyway, when a client came to his patron in need of something, I mean, this was a real relationship that had social pressures on it, where it had to work. It's not like the patron could just blow off his client. It was expected. He would give his client what he needed. It would be dishonorable for him not to do that. So there was real social pressure to make sure that this worked. So the patron was supposed to provide the client what they needed if it was within his power to provide it. That is what a reliable patron would do. So if this friend at midnight, this friend, again, friend can mean a lot of different things, including patron and client. If this friend is a patron, he is being a very rude and a very bad patron because he really doesn't want to give his client anything. He doesn't want to get up and get out of bed and wake his children up and give him bread, even though socially he is obligated to do that. He's not being a very good patron. Well, here's the thing. This is where I think this might be at work in the parable. We have from around Jesus' time lots of writings from Greeks and Romans and Jews that talked about the gods, or if they're Jews, talked about God as the ultimate patron. And human beings were his clients. They came to him for what they needed. He gave them what they needed. In return, you worship the gods. Or in return, you worship the one true God. So a lot of people conceived of God in terms of this patron-client relationship. God was understood as like the ultimate patron. And since this parable is in the context of praying to God, at the beginning, Jesus gives the model prayer, and then after this, he talks about ask and seek and knock, and your Father will give you what you need. It's in the context of God relating to people, and all of a sudden, we're also talking about friends. So in this context, it seems like a patron-client relationship is what is going on in the parable, because people thought about how they related to God, how they prayed to God in terms of this patron-client relationship. So this friend would correspond to the way a lot of people thought about God. But in the parable, this friend is not a very reliable patron. Again, he doesn't want to get out of bed. He doesn't want to give this friend knocking on his door what he needs. He only acts for his client when the client basically wears him out, just knocking and knocking and knocking and not giving up. So the patron comes this close to breaking that socially enforced relationship, the patron and client relationship. He comes this close to just blowing it off, but he finally decides to get up and give him the bread. Well, in contrast to this bad patron, God is a reliable patron. That is what Jesus is saying. When he says, you know, ask, seek, knock. Your Father knows how to give you good gifts like a father gives to his children. He teaches the Lord's Prayer. In contrast, God is a reliable patron. He is a trustworthy one. He is a true friend. And so unlike this patron in the parable, when we come to God with our needs, like the friend at midnight needed bread, when we come to God with our needs, Jesus is saying we can count on him to meet those needs. He honors that relationship that we have entered into with him. He will honor it. He will not come close to breaking it. He will not break it. He will uphold his end of the relationship. Unlike the friend here who comes this close to breaking that relationship. So, was that, I don't know how I did it explaining that. Was that clear? Was that strange? Any thoughts on it?
Yes, in French, patron, patron.
Yeah. Yeah.
Boss.
Oh, yeah, it's boss. So that kind of goes back to, I guess it probably developed out of something like this. Yeah. If we could get the microphone over to Linda, she had her hand up.
I had a little trouble understanding this earlier when he said, but as a friend, like where it backs up, he said he didn't want to do it. But when you explained this, the patron, the client, and the friend in another term, it really set it in perspective. So that was...
I think it also helps us hear the parable the way Jesus's audience would have heard it. They would not have heard it as like, oh, that friend who's in bed, I sympathize, I wouldn't want to get out of bed either. They would. That's how we would hear it. They would hear it as, that guy better get up and give him bread. He's supposed to do that. And so it's like shocking when he's like, I don't want to do that. And God is saying, I am not like that. I give things when you ask. I'm reliable. Yeah. And clients, this is not just like a system of like giving birthday presents. They depended on these people to survive. Like a lot of the clients are poor and their patrons are wealthy. Those patrons had to be reliable if they were going to make ends meet. So that's another aspect of this. Like, we need God to survive spiritually, and he will not let us down. Kelsey.
I also agree. I think that makes sense. And for some reason, I've never heard that before, that explanation about the patron. But I think the point, like, that you're saying he's making as well is he's trying to get like this shock value. That's what he normally does. I mean, Good Samaritan, like there's this shock value with it. And I mean, I think it's more shocking even in our terms when we, you know, see what father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will give him a serpent instead. Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion. So it's, I think that's the point, is he's being very extreme to try to get them to see the contrast between God and, you know, how people should have been. So I think that makes a lot more sense to me too, that people would have reacted to that in the same way of, you know, that shock value.
Yeah. And with Jesus saying that stuff about, will he give him, I can't remember the exact ones. I know there's the scorpion and I think there's the snake, the egg. I also wonder if maybe there's a little bit of humor going on there. You know, it's hard for us to pick up on humor. Partially because we read this as Holy Scripture, so we want to take it seriously. And also, I don't think the gospel writers were intending to write something funny. But I do think there's probably a little bit of humor value in here, and I would imagine Jesus' audience is meant to be kind of smiling and realizing, oh yeah, that would be ridiculous, you know, to make his point. Yeah. Well, it's 5:50, so we've pretty well gone the whole hour. Thank you all for your comments tonight. Thank you for listening to that the patron-client deal. If that stuck with you, great. If not, the good news is the parable is still understandable without it, and it's all right. But I hope that maybe shed some new light on the parable. But let's close with a prayer, and then we'll be dismissed. I'm going to ask, Jason, would you be willing maybe to say a closing prayer for us, and then we'll be done.
Bow with me, please. Our dear, kind Heavenly Father, Lord, we humbly come before you again this evening, God, thankful for the time that we've had together to study another portion of your word, Heavenly Father, to look into these teachings of Jesus, these parables, Heavenly Father, and that we can pull them out and apply these things to our lives to better understand, you know, what it is that you expect of us, Heavenly Father, to understand our relationship with you as we, again, come to you in prayer, Heavenly Father. We're thankful for this avenue of communication that we have, Lord, that we can reach out to you, Lord, that we can lean upon you, that we can make our wants and needs and wishes known, Heavenly Father. And we know that we may not always understand your response. We may not always see it the way that you do, that our will may not always align with your will. But we pray, Heavenly Father, that we would continue to come to you, Heavenly Father, that we may try to understand your will, that we may try to align your will with our will here on this earth. Lord, again, we're just thankful for all that you do for us. We're thankful for Christ Jesus, the sacrifice that he has made for us, Heavenly Father. Lord, we pray that you would bless everyone who's here tonight, Lord, and that you would watch over us as we are about to be departed. We would go to our homes, Heavenly Father. We pray that you would guide us, guard us, and keep us, Lord, until we come back again. Again, Lord, thankful for so many things. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you be with those that are mentioned on our prayer list, so many that are sick and suffering, Heavenly Father, and we just pray that you would lay your healing hands upon them, Lord, and again, continue to be with the congregation here in Nicholasville as we continue to search your word, Heavenly Father, as we try to grow in strength and love and knowledge. We ask all these things in Christ's precious name. Amen.